Okay, so today we're gonna do "Down in the Tube Station at Midnight" full version by The Jam. I thought I listened to The Jam or reacted to The Jam actually recently, but actually it's been over a month, and I thought I kind of want to get back into them. And this song has been requested a couple times. Apparently, it's one of their best. So we're gonna get into this and see what's going on. And yeah, so let's just get in and go. I feel like I'm in a tube station.
The distant echo of faraway voices brought in faraway trains to take them home to the ones that they love and who love them forever. The Christ 30 steps, repeat my own and reflect my thoughts. Calling and inviting, partially naked, but so far, toffee wrappers and the smallest papers. Mr. Jones got run down. Headlines of death and sorrow, they tear off tomorrow. Madmen on the rampage. And I'm down in a tube station at midnight.
I like the quickness.
I fumble for change. I pull out the queen, smiling, beguiling. I put in the money and pull out a plum behind me. Whispers in the shadows, gruff blazing voices, hating, waiting. Hey boy, hey shout, have you got any money? And I say, I'm gonna take money and I take away the curry. I'm on the way home to my wife. She'll be lining up the cutlery and now she's expecting me, polishing her glasses and pulling out the cork. I'm down in a tube station at midnight.
Like a back.
First felt a fist and then a kick. I could now smell their breath. They smelt of pubs and wormwood scrubs and too many right-wing meetings. My life swam around me. It took a look and drowned me in its own existence. The smell of brown leather evening in with the weather. Feel my eyes, his nose, I'm not blood. So my senses could see, hear, speak any longer. I'm down in a tube station at midnight. I said I was down in a tube station at midnight. The last thing I know, so I'm lying there on a boat. Jesus, I was fighting by, like the years.
Okay. Down in the Tube Station at Midnight by The Jam. I have to say, this song lived up to the hype that I've been told. Good Lord. You know, starting off with that atmospheric, you know, kind of a feel, whatever sound. And then just with, I mean, you know, by the title, you know, down in the Tube Station, I mean, you can hear the train, I guess you would say. I don't even know where to start. You know, I guess, you know, to start off, Bruce Foxton, good Lord, Bruce Foxton here. That bass, and I heard, you know, people were telling me before this, you know, Bruce Foxton is really good in this, kind of underrated. And, I mean, yeah, if, I guess you could pay more attention, I guess, to, like, Paul Weller's vocals. And, I mean, Rick on the drums as well. What's his last name again? Rick Buckler on the drums as well. I loved his speed. That's what I said during the song as well. But, yeah, Bruce Foxton, and then his backing vocals as well. I know his backing vocals, they weren't, he was just going, whoa, or whatever. They weren't, you know, extravagant, whatever. He wasn't, like, singing as much as Paul or anything like that. But, I don't know, I just really liked his vocal sound. And, yeah, again, his bass playing was just off, you know, off the charts here. And also, I never really noticed until when I was listening to him now. Maybe it's because I was listening to The Clash today. But I hear, and I guess you would say, actually, when was this song? This song came out in 1978. So I guess The Clash were around at the same time. But I hear some Joe Strummer in Paul Weller's voice. And, or you could say maybe there's some Paul Weller and Joe Strummer's voice, but, just, I don't know, it's just that kind of, maybe, I wouldn't say careless, because, you know, they care and all this stuff, but it's just like, they can sing, but they don't, I don't know what it is, they have an aura about them of, like, singing kind of a dirty kind of a singing. It's just their voice is kind of gruff, and, they just, I don't know, they're not, like, you know, polished singers or whatever, and I just love that. And that's what I was thinking when I was listening. I was like, I'm getting Joe Strummer vibes for some reason. And anyway, I mean, yeah, I really like the song. I mean, what else can I really say except, yeah, I really liked it. And again, yeah, just Bruce Foxton on that bass was terrific. And then Rick Buckler, again, when he was drumming there near, I'd say maybe like 3 minutes or more. I should have looked, but anyway, it was near in the end, I guess. But anyway, he was drumming, and then it was like a sound of a train was coming, but I don't know if the train was actually coming or not. I don't know, or maybe it was just his drumming. I was just, if you saw him on my face, I guess maybe I'll put when it happens, I look confused, I think, but because I was like, whoa, and then it's a train. Maybe it's just the train sound with his drumming, I guess, at the same time. But that just kind of confused me for a second, because I was like, whoa, was that him drumming too or whatever? Yeah, I was just like, good Lord. I mean, each member of the band was on top in this song. I can see why people are saying this song's really good, because it is. And actually, you know, doing this recording, why I'm doing it is because That's Entertainment, a song that I reacted to by them, has been in my head all day for some reason. I don't know why. And I was like, I want to hear more from The Jam. And yeah, and again, just, I don't know, I just love their sound. And again, I know people are saying the band didn't really get big, too big, I guess, in the U.S. Again, it's like a U.K. They're kind of huge in the U.K. and not really big in the U.S. or whatever. And kind of reminds me of the band that's on my shirt. But, you know, and I guess, you know, wearing the shirt, Oasis shirt, kind of goes with this reaction. Because I know Noel Gallagher took a lot from Paul Weller. And I know I think Paul Weller played on some Oasis songs. But anyway, yeah. And I know as well. I feel like I'm talking a lot, but I have a lot to talk about. I like dissecting the stuff here, and I know people like hearing me dissect stuff. So anyway, with the lyricism here, I was reading some comments and like on the video, and some comments that people have left me, and it gave me something to think about with how, you know, The Jam didn't make it, and many other bands of that time from the UK didn't really make it big in the US, and a lot of people are saying it's because of the you know, the lyrics being complex. And you know, maybe not saying that, you know, Americans are dumb, but like, yeah, it's just like, I guess, you know, some American music, it's like more straightforward, I guess you could say. It's not as, you know, the lyricism is not as key or whatever, I guess you could say. And here, it's just, I can really see that happening. And I mean, you think of, like, I mean, even with like how now I'm just thinking of, like, American Woman by the Guess Who, how that went to number one in the States, and they didn't even realize what the song was really about. It was about, you know, It was making fun of, you know, the United States or whatever. It's just, you know, I think of that kind of a thing. And I'm like, it does kind of ring true that, like, you know, the complexity of some of, you know, some UK bands goes over Americans' heads. Yeah, I don't know. I just really thought that was a cool thought. And anyway, I mean, we're 10 minutes into this and I haven't really talked much about, you know, the lyric, I guess, you know, the about of the song or whatever. But anyway, let's get into this. Just to talk some more. So it says, you know, the about here on Genius, it says, the song kicks off with a great marrying of ambient sounds of the underground with its ripping bass line. Again, the bass line, Bruce was awesome here. You want to prove your karaoke chops through the song, right? So anyway, again, just talking about how the jam is, you know, hard to replicate pretty much. But there is as well, I just want to see, you know, on Song Facts, it says, here on Song Facts, this anti-racism song was a first-person narrative about a brutal mugging by jackbooted right-wing thugs in London. Despite having a BBC airplay ban due to its disturbing nature, it became the jam's second UK top 20 hit. The then Radio 1 DJ Tony Blackburn complained that it's disgusting the way punks sing about violence. Why can't they sing about trees and flowers? I don't know, is he being sarcastic or is he actually saying that? Because, you know, does he know what punk is? I don't know. Anyway, and then we have here another point. In his teens, Paul Weller idealized London. He would catch a train from Woking, and carry a tape recorder around Capital just to be able to hear the streets again and again. However, after writing and recording two jam albums in 6 months and endless touring, he suffered premature burnout. Chastened by the experience, he emerged a more bitter, cynical person, and he penned the song from the perspective of an ordinary working man on the way back to his suburban home who was beaten by senseless skinheads. So yeah, I got that feeling when I was listening to it and, you know, actually kind of looking at the lyrics at the same time, because it talks about how, at one point, it talks about right wing, and I was thinking, are they talking about, you know, politics, I guess? Like when it says it doesn't show the, like, which verse numbers, but anyway, when he says here, good Lord, I can't find it now. Okay. I felt, this is when he's, I guess, getting punched and kicked, obviously. I first felt a fist and then a kick. I could now smell their breath. They smell like, the smell of pubs and wormwood scrubs. Obviously these people are drunk and too many right-wing meetings. So right there, I was like, oh, right-wing. Okay. My life swam around me. It took a look and drowned me in its own existence. The smell of brown leather, it blended with the weather. It filled my ears, my eyes, ears, nose, and mouth. It blocked all my senses. So, you know, when he's saying the leather, you know, what I get in my head is like a belt, I would say, something like that. Or maybe the boots, I guess. Either way, I mean, he's getting beat, blocked all my senses. He's getting beat senseless is what it sounds like. Couldn't see, hear, speak any longer. And I'm down in the tube station at midnight. Said I was down in the tube station at midnight. And I mean, yeah, I guess at some points you don't want to be down in the tube station at midnight. And then also here, it says, the last thing I saw as I lay there on the floor was Jesus Saves, painted by an atheist nutter. Like, some of these lines, I was taken aback by. I was like, what does this mean, really? Jesus Saves by an atheist nutter. So I guess, you know, if you're just looking at it, you know, as it is, you know, just the atheist kind of being, I guess, funny or whatever, you know, Jesus Saves. And obviously, Jesus didn't save this poor worker at this point. And actually, you know, what's really going through my head is the scene from Joker when Arthur, I couldn't remember his name, but, you know, Joaquin Phoenix's character gets beat up by, you know, a businessman. It's not the same scene, but, you know, he's getting beat up on the train and stuff. And then he ends up shooting them and everything. So that's a different scene, actually. But that's what was going through my head just because I like that movie a lot. But anyway, yeah, a lot to go through here. It's such a good song. The whole anti-racism thing, I mean, especially for 1978, again, when it was saying about that quote from the DJ who said, can't they just, you know, sing about trees and flowers and something, or something like that? It's like, that's not punks. That's not what punk's about. And I guess, I never really thought about the Jam as a punk band, but I guess they kind of are, I guess, yeah. I don't know why, I just thought, you know, I guess it's alternative rock. Yeah, I guess they're still kind of alternative rock, but I never really thought about them just being a punk band. But yeah, maybe that's why I was thinking of Joe Strummer's voice as well. It just has that kind of similarity. But anyway, I guess I've babbled on enough here. Great song, great lyrics, great song for the time as well. 1978, we're talking about these subjects. I mean, you had other bands out there at the same time talking about, you know, heavy subjects like the Sex Pistols, even the Clash again, you know, and subjects that were seen as taboo. You know, don't talk about violence. You know, we want to hear some happy things. And again, it's just like, I feel like that was the kind of the UK kind of a scene. They talked about serious things and stuff. And again, American bands did too. But again, it feels like the UK was just, the UK did it better. I mean, I like UK music more than American music, I think. And anyway, that's about it. Thanks for watching. Thanks for liking, subscribing, commenting. I really appreciate all the support, and I will talk to you guys. I feel like it went over so much in this. I talk so much. But anyway, I'll talk to you guys again soon.